And
what about you?
I how do they not know you're the one guy not to ask to MC it when I'm giving the talk? Because we do this on Friday nights. Catholic Answers gives a free talk in San Diego once a month, one Friday. And Father Tazi over at St. Therese of Carmel Parish is so good to let us use that beautiful hall they have over there. And he always comes. Mm-hmm. And then you MC'd. And can I tell how did you hear about his introduction, Darren? Because he said, this is Joe introducing me. He tells a story about Evelyn Waugh. You know Evelyn Waugh, who the first thing you have to say when you say Evelyn Waugh is, he's a man. Yes. Like, everybody's like, wait,
not Evelyn.
Wait, are you using the wrong pronouns? No, that's apparently some kind of British thing where you can have men named Evelyn.
Well, a fun or side Cyril. Digression.
Yeah.
A lot of girls' names used to be boys' names.
A lot of girls' names used to be boys' names. Like, give me an example.
Like Evelyn, like Hillary.
Oh, that's right, Hillary.
Like, if you think about like early
right.
20th century Catholic authors, they have what we now regard
as Hillary Vellick and Evelyn Waugh.
Yeah, exactly.
Both dudes. Okay, yeah, I didn't think about that.
And Bobby McGee was originally a girl in the song. So, almost any boy's name you can think of.
Wait a second. How did Bobby McGee...
No, I'm just thinking, think about, the masculinist, the manliest, male names, Frank and Bob, and we're already starting to see variations for girls. And it doesn't really go the other direction. So a lot of Stevie Nicks would be another example of, taking an obvious boy's name and, modifying it so it can become a girl's name. A lot of girls' names, if you look at the origins.
Do you agree with Bobby McGee that... freedom is just another word
for nothing left to lose. No, that's of all the definitions of freedom I've heard, that is arguably the worst.
There is a kind of freedom that comes with nothing left to lose.
Yeah.
You know, that's kind of a Franciscan freedom.
Yeah, but I like the way you... it sounds much more nihilistic in the song, but I like the way you take it as the freedom of poverty.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's why some saints choose poverty, is because to be free to live the gospel every day, however the Lord calls them that day.
And so, in all seriousness, in that sense, there is something to that, not just for poverty, but also even for celibacy. Jesus talks about celibacy as living like the angels. There's a sort of eschatological anticipation. Looking forward to the life to come when you embrace the celibate state.
Yeah.
So there's something really beautiful and really rich about that. I'm not sure if that was what Bobby McGee meant, though. But yeah.
No, I think that Bobby McGee had other things in mind. But okay, so here's how, Darren, I wanted to tell you this, and then we'll get on with the show. Are we doing a show today? Yeah, we are. Open forum.
If we can squeeze any colors.
Okay, but this was the worst introduction I've ever received in my life. The single worst introduction than ever. Joe said, he tells this story about Evelyn Waugh that many people have heard about, the very beautiful Catholic novelist wrote the book Helena, wrote, what's the most famous one? It just went out of my head.
Brideshead Revisited.
Which is, they've never made a good movie out of Brideshead Revisited yet.
But the BBC series, it's 11 hours long.
Is it good?
Oh, yeah. They ran out of money to adapt it, so they just played it straight.
I like it. Okay, so Evelyn Waugh, notoriously also grumpy. Person. Evelyn Waugh actually had some, people don't like to mention this part, but he actually had some quite serious mental health challenges. But so he's a very grumpy man. And so he goes out to dinner and he's grumpy with the wait staff the entire time. He's a jerk to them the entire time. And at the end, the waitress says to him, she says, "You're so rude. You're a rude man. And you, a Catholic." And he says to her, "Imagine what I would be like if I wasn't a Catholic." And Joe says, "This is a perfect description of Cy." That's how he starts. That's his introduction at me.
The audience loved it. The centrality of the Lord to your life. What was wrong with that? It was divine grace. You know, without Jesus, you can do nothing.
And then it got worse because Joe said, I was instructed to give a biography of Cy, but he didn't bother to look up anything about me. So he just made it up. And in his biography of me, my mother was an aspiring actress. My father was a carnival barker. What other things were in there? I don't know.
You had a falling out with a gentleman by the name of Whitey Bulger.
Oh, yeah, Whitey Bulger.
I was trying to figure out how you came from Boston to San Diego, and this was a plausible. More than one person asked if that.
And then later,
true.
You didn't know this. Later, I told you my story about that. I might have met Whitey Bulger one time.
So it turned out in just randomly reaching, I found that out I kind of did. Yes, I found out better information about you than if I just read your bio on our website.
All right, it was the meanest introduction ever. But the audience really liked it.
Yes.
They really liked it. The number is 888-318-7884. Peter in Oregon, you are going to start us off. I said Oregon, right? Mm-hmm. I didn't say Oregon. Oregon, because I got instructed by Archbishop Sample, who apparently thinks he's some kind of, I got to do what he says. He's not here, right? He said I have to say Oregon. Peter in Oregon, watching on YouTube, you are numero uno today, Peter. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
Hey, thanks for having me on. And hey, I love the show with the Archbishop Sample, and he definitely gave you some good advice there. And sorry about the Celtics.
Thank you very much for all of that. It wasn't advice, though. That was clearly direction. And the Celtics and I are not getting along right now. We're having a problem getting along.
Well, my question is around degrees of reverence for sacred images, in particular digital ones. Like, are all digital sacred images considered equal in reverence? For example, for some reason, I feel okay having pictures of Mary as the background for my phone, but not of the Eucharist.
Oh, yeah, how interesting.
I absolutely get that. I have the same kind of gut sense as you. That's a great question. I have not seen any good direct answer to that, because I think in some ways it's just too new of an issue, you know, until very, very recently, people didn't have phones that they were putting images in the background of. But yeah, even like on Facebook and other social media, where you see like images of the Eucharistic Lord, it's hard to know how to respond. I think the first thing I'd say is an image is that. It's an image. And so in that sense, whether it's a painting or a photograph or a live stream, it's different than seeing the person themselves. So I would default to what the Second Council of Nicaea says back in the 8th century. And we have to adapt this for the modern context. They're dealing with things like paintings and icons. And they lay down this, that people are drawn to honor these images with the offering of incense and lights, as was piously established by ancient custom. Indeed, the honor paid to an image traverses it, reaching the model. And he who venerates the image venerates the person represented in that image. So they would say the image isn't the saint. The image isn't Christ. But rather is like a doorway. And you are not giving any kind of honor to the painting itself. I mean, you could imagine, like if you're an art critic, you could just say, oh, wow, I don't know who this painting is of, but it's so beautiful. But when you're doing religious devotion, you're not really doing that. You are instead, as if through the window of the painting, honoring the saint or honoring Christ. So in that sense, it does seem appropriate that even while we recognize a picture of the Eucharist isn't the Eucharist, nevertheless, it's a window to the Eucharist. And so I try to give the kind of reverence. You know, I'm not going to superficially treat an image of the Eucharist for that reason. So I don't know. Again, I don't have a clearer bit of advice from the church, but the last time the church gave very clear advice on this back in the 8th century, that advice was to treat the thing with the respect that you would treat the one that the thing represents.
What do you think, Peter?
I think that's great. Should I ask a quick follow-up?
Yes, please do.
What about digital images compared to maybe printed ones or a statue? Would we treat them any differently? Because, for instance, I know for maybe a sacred statue or a picture, you would need to maybe burn it or treat it a certain way to dispose it. Any type of insights around that? Mostly just out of curiosity.
Yeah, that's a really good question. In terms of especially like blessed objects, blessed images, there we have a strong resistance to treating sacred things in a way that's profane, meaning like worldly or vulgar or ordinary. And so we want to treat religious depictions in a respectful way. That doesn't mean that like if you've got an image of the Eucharist on your phone, you have to like burn your phone before you can change your background. But it does mean that you should approach it with reverence. And in some ways, I think this is just uncharted territory, because the typical ways a physical object that's been blessed is handled is you either burn it, or you bury it, or you bequeath it to somebody else, just to keep the B alliteration going. You can, you know, give it away. But with something like a digital file, none of those are options. Like, none of those apply. And so just like with something like intellectual property, it's going to be very different when you copy a song somebody has than if you steal their piano. Likewise, the concepts of treating a thing with dignity that's been blessed or that's sacred in origin are going to be very different when we're talking about the digital realm than the physical realm.
You know what, Peter? I'm going to leave it there because I just realized we are right up on it for the break. So we'll take a quick break. All the lines are full. Looking forward to lots of questions. Joe Heschmeyer is our guest. It's open forum. More of that right after this.
Catholic Answers Live.
The Aquinas Writing Advantage Program is part of Homeschool Connections' set of online courses for your Catholic homeschool. Homeschool Connections' website is homeschoolconnections.com.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
I don't like looking back. I prefer to look forward and keep moving forward. There's plenty to cover. I do a lot of research and try to dig out the bits and pieces of a life or of an agenda that people don't want to talk about.
The World Over with Raymond Arroyo, Thursday night, 8 Eastern, on EWTN Radio and Television.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Joe Heschmeyer is our guest. Both hours, and both hours open forum. There's Nathaniel Check. Nathaniel, did you and your dad go to Steubenville? Did you go to, is that where your dad was, taking you to see your college? All right. And you are still valedictorian of your class. They're not taking that away. You're still valedictorian? Yeah.
Okay. Meanwhile, the listeners are like, what are you talking about over the break, if this is what you talk about on the air?
Well, actually, over the break, we were talking about, Darren had a really good question, because there's this thing called an NFT, which is a...
Non-fungible token.
Yeah, non-fungible token. That's what I was going to say.
I think this is a sore subject to people who've been investing in those recently. They have not been doing great.
Well, could you get a non-fungible token blessed?
And then could you sell it?
And then if it was blessed, could you sell it?
Then Edgar asked, can you bless digital things? And I said, finger rosaries.
Yes, you did, Joe. You did say that. And you, for some reason, you were proud of it. Joseph in St. Louis, Missouri, listening on Catholic.com. I'm glad you're here, Joseph. Go ahead with your question for Joe. No? Joseph? I hear some activity, but we're going to come back to you, Joseph. Right now, I believe the name is West. Out here in California, listening to EWTN on Channel 130 Sirius XM Satellite Radio. West, are you there with us?
Yeah, how are you doing today?
Very well, thank you. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
Yeah, my question is about the Eucharist. And I'm curious why in, for instance, some of the Episcopal churches, they're still doing their communion service with or their Eucharist with the bread and the wine, and at Mass, in a couple of different churches I've attended Mass over the past several months, there is no wine, there is no blood, per se, and we're doing the bread, and we're doing the beautiful Eucharist, and I love Mass, and I love the liturgy, and I love the whole thing, but I'm just curious why we're not partaking in the wine of the blood and Catholic Mass.
Yeah, that's a great question, and one that's been kind of a hot topic for about 500 years. Really, actually even 600 years, because Jan Hus raised the same objection back in the 15th century. There's two dimensions to it. So yesterday was the Feast of Corpus Christi, and in some churches, before the Gospel, there is a sequence, is what it's called, which is like a hymn, basically, that's sung called the Lauda Sion. It's written by St. Thomas Aquinas, written for this feast, which is just a proclamation of the church's belief about the Eucharist. And one of the things that is proclaimed in there is that even though Christ comes to us under the appearances of bread and wine, that whether you receive one or both, you receive the entire Lord, that we don't sever him, we don't rend him, we don't break him. So he says, carochibus, flesh from bread and blood from wine, yet in Christ in either sign all entire confessed to be, that all of Christ is present in the smallest particle of the host. All of Christ is present in the smallest drop from the chalice. And that's because Christ isn't separate flesh and blood like he was on the cross, that he is the risen, glorified Christ that we're receiving. So in that sense, you don't have to receive both in order to receive Christ, just like you don't have to have a lot of Eucharist to receive Christ. You can have the smallest or the largest quantity, and you're still receiving all of Christ. It's the exact same. But then the second half of that question is more of a pastoral or prudential judgment of like, well, should we still commune the faithful with the chalice? Because the priest receives under both species every time. The celebrant has to. The faithful don't have to. The pros are, it's the way Jesus did it at the Last Supper. He gave everybody both the chalice as well as the bread that had become his body. The cons are that it's more time-consuming, there's more risk of profanation in the sense of people spilling, and in the old days, wine was much more expensive and tasted very bad in Northern Europe, and so there were some really pragmatic considerations that led to the withholding of the chalice. So there aren't great arguments, in my view, that are just overwhelming in either direction. You're not theologically required to do one way or the other. In many parishes, they'll offer the chalice, and people may come up or they may not come up. So it's just one of those things where I think, honestly, it's as much a logistical issue as anything else. If you've got one priest communing the entire congregation, that's a lot harder to do for administering both species. Does that make sense?
Well,
Interestingly
enough, when I converted from the Episcopal Church, obviously I had to go through some of the sacraments, and the communion was one of them. And at that one, I was given the chalice.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it felt very familiar coming from the Episcopal Church, where you pretty much do it Sunday in, Sunday out. But I'm much more happy at home here in the Catholic Church. I've asked, and I get different answers from everybody, so this was interesting.
Oh, good. Well, hopefully. I mean, and you can find, I mean, depending on what diocese you're in, you can usually find parishes that do it both ways.
West, I'm going to leave it there. Joseph in St. Louis, apparently the line is solid again. So Joseph in St. Louis, Missouri, watching on Catholic.com. You are up next. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
Well, thank you guys for taking my call. I really appreciate it. Love your guys' show.
Thank you.
So here, I'll get straight to my question. So in 1st, 2nd Samuel, you know, it says that God gave into David's hand or Saul's hand the Philistines or the Amorites or the Amalekites, whoever. It says God gave into David's hand the Philistines or whoever. And my question is what does that mean? Does that mean that God gave David and his army super strength to defeat the Philistines? Does it mean that God made the Philistines stupid and they just were weak all of a sudden? Or what does that mean exactly?
I see. Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, on the most basic level, to say that God delivered the Philistines or whoever into David's hands and Saul's hands just means that God gave victory in the battle. But I think your question is more the mechanism of, well, how did he bring about that victory? And the easiest answer to that is it doesn't say. It doesn't say here's exactly the way the battle went. We're just told the outcome of the battle. So I'm thinking of like 1 Samuel 23, but there are other examples of this. Where all we hear is that, you know, we won, they lost, without any of the details of that. And there are any number of ways. So I wrote an article for Catholic Answers Magazine several issues back now that looks at this when it talks about the angel of the Lord defeating the enemies of Israel with Sennacherib. And it's really cool because even though, as here, the biblical account is a little sparse, it doesn't tell us what it means. We have in that case parallel accounts, because Sennacherib's invasion of Israel was like really well documented by Assyrian sources, by Babylonian sources, by Egyptian ones. And all of those accounts differ, but they agree in the main. So it's pretty clear even from the Assyrian account that they were winning and then suddenly they turned back and went back home. And they don't tell us why, obviously. There's some indication from the Egyptian accounts that this might have been an outbreak of mice that ate the bowstrings of the archers. So they suddenly woke up and didn't have weapons anymore. And that is one way the angel of the Lord can be visited upon the enemies of Israel. The biblical account doesn't tell us that, and we wouldn't have known that. We would only know that, like, God brought about a victory, and, you know, the Assyrians went home with the tails between their legs after seeming to be in, you know, a sure victory. And with the Philistines, we're not even given that much information. We don't have these parallel sources to say, well, what was the means by which God brought about a victory? But that gives us one concrete example of what that might look like. There's a natural disaster, there's an outbreak of disease, there's plague, or there's infestation, or there's any of these other things that keep the free will of everyone intact, and yet God still works out the victory in a very clear way.
Joseph, I will leave it there. Thanks very, very much. Lines continue full. It's open forum here on Catholic Answers Live. We go now up to Oregon. Casey in Oregon, watching on YouTube. Casey, you there with us?
Hello.
Hi, Casey. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
Okay, so I usually talk with Protestants, and sometimes they point out that they ask, like, why are a lot of the canonized saints white or, like, European? And they say that, and they sometimes point at this and say, see, Catholicism is a quote-unquote white religion because they favor the canonization of white saints and how the church isn't racially diverse in their saint selection and is white-ruled in that area. How do they, is this true, and how do we respond to those who attack Catholicism this way?
Casey, that's a great question. Let me unpack that a few different ways. It's Juneteenth, so it seems appropriate to talk about all these things. I'd say, first of all, there's way more diversity among canonized saints than there is among, say, Protestant reformers, which are, you know, all European. Or, you know, so, like, it's a weird
or
objection.
Or in a Catholic church. You walk into most Catholic churches, it's just a pretty diverse place.
Yeah. One time I compared a very, like, proud of itself for being diverse and inclusive parish with literally just pulling up the Archdiocese of Washington, which is where I was living at the time, and looked at the first 10 seminarians that they had listed. And there was way more diversity. And so the church is much more Catholic, much more universal than almost any Protestant denomination. I think it was G.K. Chesterton who talked about the absurdity of imagining a Southern Baptist Mongolian. It just doesn't make sense. I mean, most Protestant denominations are, you know, local. They, in many cases, were explicitly ethnic or racial. You know, the Southern Baptists break away from the Northern Baptists because they want to keep slaves. So you often have these much more ethnocentric and racialized understandings of Christianity. Now, Catholicism was not spared that entirely. You'll definitely find plenty of racism in the church's history. You'll also just find, I think, as a natural kind of consequence, that the evangelization of Europe happened first. So as you go back, you'll find a lot of European saints before you get, you know, missionaries to the New World because they didn't know the New World existed yet. So I'd say for all of those reasons, yeah, you'll find a lot of white saints.
Can we continue this on the other side?
Yeah, let's continue that on the other side.
I actually would like to add one thing, if I may. May I?
You may.
Oh, good. We'll be right back. More Catholic Answers Live.
Have you enrolled in the Catholic Answers School of Apologetics? Let me ask you a more important question. Do you believe as a Catholic that you have an obligation to share the Catholic faith? In fact, the Church has answered this question, and the answer is that all confirmed Catholics are obliged to share the faith. It's actually in canon law. Catholic Answers is here to help you fulfill that obligation. Our School of Apologetics courses will equip you to help all the people you come in contact with understand what the Church teaches and why. A great place to start is with all the Catholics in your life. Learn the art of apologetics from the best of the best and start sharing the gospel today. Visit schoolofapologetics.com. That's schoolofapologetics.com. Here's a question. Is it really possible to be friends with someone who died 2,000 years ago? Maybe the problem is that we've grown way too comfortable with the story of Jesus. Nice man, right? Taught us to love one another, said not to judge people. We celebrate his birthday every year. It's time to put away this small, safe version of Jesus, says Cy Kellett. Nobody that bland could have transformed the world. In A Teacher of Strange Things, Cy presents Jesus Christ undiluted by sentiment, with all his radical words and deeds uncensored. Do you know someone, your son or daughter perhaps, or maybe your mom or dad, who needs the friendship of Jesus Christ? Do you? Order your copy of A Teacher of Strange Things by visiting shop.catholic.com today or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Did you know you can access Catholic Answers Live right from your phone or other mobile device? Download the Catholic Answers Live app today. The Catholic Answers Live app, available now on iOS and Android.
Tomorrow on Mortal Life, the life you were meant to live.
We'll look at how the theology of the body can help you live a more abundant life.
That's tomorrow on Mortal Life, 10 a.m. Eastern, 9 Central on EWTN Radio.
Now back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. Joe Heschmeyer is our guest, and he has given me permission to say something, so this is going to be very exciting. Casey is on with us, calling from Oregon, asking about a challenge made to him about why Catholic saints are, they seem to be so white. Why so many Catholic saints are white? Does that mean that the Catholic Church prefers white people to other people? Do I have that correct, Casey? Is Casey?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Sorry to wake you up.
You're mean. You're a mean person.
I am a mean person. But Joe was given a bit of an answer, but I would like to add something that I think where many often Catholics are shy about talking about, and I don't think that we should be talking about it. After the death and resurrection of Jesus, the gospel went out in every direction, including Africa and Asia, not just to Europe. The reason that we think of the church as European is because of what happened in the 6th, 7th, and 8th century, no, 7th and 8th centuries, and 9th century, because Islam came across North Africa and Asia and cut Christianity in half. So many people, for example, today think the gospel didn't do very well in Asia. The gospel did very well in Asia. I mean, with Chaldean Catholics, Assyrian Catholics, Malabar, Syro-Malabar Catholics, Nestorian Catholics, all the way to China and Mongolia. Genghis Khan's mother was a Christian. And so the gospel did very, very well. Christianity was cut in half by Islam in the 7th, 8th, and 9th century. So, excuse me, I keep saying that wrong. It's really the, 7th, 8th, and 9th century, right. Yeah, so, I mean, and the church did not get to be fully international again until Europeans invented ships that could go around Islam. It's as basic as that. Until the Europeans invented the technology to get around Islam, the church was trapped. And so, I don't think it's true that most of the saints are white or that there's even a predominance of white saints. I think if we want to talk about diversity, there's probably more Catholic buildings named after women and minorities than any other institution in the world, certainly more than any government in the world. So that gives you a sense of the diversity of the Catholic Church. But I didn't want to just neglect to mention Islam because it's an important part of the story.
Yeah, that's true. When you think about the historic hubs of Christianity in the very early days, you've got Jerusalem, Antioch, which is down in Syria, Alexandria, which is in Egypt, Rome, which is in Italy, and then eventually you've got Constantinople, which is in Turkey. That is not overwhelmingly white.
Not
I mean,
at all.
No, it's very tricky, like how you define whiteness and are Turks white, and, you know, all of those kind of silly questions. But when people say this is so white, blah, 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 they typically mean after, as you said, after Europe gets kind of trapped in and is surrounded suddenly on, you know, its southern and eastern flanks by Muslims who aren't receptive to the spread of the gospel, to put it mildly, then yeah, it turns out they evangelize north. They evangelize the pagans in Germany and in Scandinavia, all of which wouldn't have been viewed as the same race at the time, by the way. Like the whole notion of whiteness and race is in so many ways a 19th century invention. So a lot of that is a little bit anachronistic. And when there is this reconnection that you kind of talk about, Cy, even in the 15th century, you see, like at the Council of Florence, for instance, you have delegations from the East and from the Coptic world who are coming to Florence to try to reunite the church. And the Christians there are like really wowed and overjoyed at seeing people they've never seen before. It isn't like, you know, it's easy to imagine something like the antebellum South, where there are white people and black people living side by side in open racial hostility. And this is more like you could go your entire life without seeing someone who doesn't look like you. And so there's a really fascinating example of this in what's called the Magi Chapel from the 15th century. There's an adoration of the Magi painting by, Benozzo Gozzoli, who it's one of the earliest depictions in Renaissance paintings of a black person who is one of the Magi. Because he just is like, oh, cool, this is what they look like. I'm going to include them in my painting. There's none of this, like, you don't see the kind of color-based racism that'll come later. And it points to the fact that this was not seemingly the mindset of Europeans. I'm sure a lot of people had crazy beliefs about what their neighbors and the neighbors beyond them looked like, believed, and so on. That's every culture has that. But you don't have, like, racism as we'll later come to understand it in the same way.
Casey, what do you think of our twin answers?
Yeah, that cleared up a lot of stuff for me. I guess what I would ask is it true that is there a dominance in, like, amount of saints? Is there numerically more white saints than, let's say, saints that are black, Asian, et cetera?
Probably.
Probably. Certainly yeah. More than you'd find in the New World. Like, if you were to compare it to, like, North and South American indigenous, because that evangelization happens so late.
Yeah.
I imagine that's going to be the case.
And it happened first in Europe?
Yeah, I mean, because evangelization in Europe happens almost immediately after Pentecost in the first century. We don't have people coming to the New World until the 15th century at least, because they don't know the New World is there. So you couldn't have a bunch of, say, Mohawk saints because no one knew the Mohawks were around.
Right.
I mean, they weren't at the time, but you know what I mean. Like, you wouldn't find Amerindian saints.
But everywhere the church goes, she makes saints so that you have people like Kateri Tekakwitha or that.
Right.
Like she doesn't like go, I'm sorry, you don't qualify as a saint, you're not white.
I mean, yeah, there's nothing like that.
Like you think of the Filipino saints who were made saints because they were evangelizing Japan, for example.
Yeah, we just had, not a couple weeks ago, St. Charles Lwanga and the Ugandan martyrs.
I mean,
you definitely have I would say that the best predictor of the number of saints is how long the place has had a strong Catholic culture. Because until you have a lot of people in that nationality who are practicing believing Catholics, you, by definition, aren't going to have a lot of canonized saints.
Okay.
I see. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. I think I really appreciate the call on Juneteenth because I know, Joe, we've spoken about this before. We're both big fans of the Juneteenth holiday. I'm very glad that we have a Juneteenth holiday, although Juneteenth was yesterday, but we still get the holiday today,
yes.
Right? But I didn't know if that was going to happen with Juneteenth. We'll still recognize it always on the 19th, even if it's on a mm-hmm. Saturday or Sunday, right? But then the day off will just move.
Yeah, which is I'm a big fan.
Because in any holidays, I have two priorities. One, priority one, what are we celebrating? And Juneteenth makes me really happy. And two, am I getting a day off for this? So, yes. Like, I'm less enthusiastic about Columbus
Day. I like
Columbus
the order you put that in. I don't think anyone believes you that that's the order of your concern.
That's the order. That's the order. I think it's very much the order. But by the way, many, many of our listeners are not here in the United States, and we try to be sensitive to that. We're Americans, so we end up talking about American stuff. So I shouldn't just assume that people know what this is, but a celebration of, essentially, it's a celebration of the emancipation of the American slaves.
It was specifically originally in Texas.
Yeah, because, and it's just that the news of emancipation came really late to the state of Texas, to certain parts of the state of Texas. And so this is a celebration of when the news of emancipation arrived in Texas. It's not a celebration of the day of the Emancipation Proclamation.
Well, yeah, it's complicated. The Emancipation Proclamation only freed slaves in Confederate territory. It didn't free slaves in Union territory.
Yeah.
So there's a lot. I mean, there's a lot that goes into that. But yeah, June 19th, 1865, General Order 3.
Right.
Texas is emancipated. And I think we actually have a call about that on line 3, by the way.
If we want to
kind of continue that theme.
We can go to the phone. But I mean, all right, let me see who we got. Let's give it to, let me just find out who's on line three. That would be Carol in Bridgewater, Massachusetts, listening to EWTN on channel 130, Sirius XM satellite radio. Carol, we're glad you're here. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
Hi. So I heard your comments that you just said about being happy about Juneteenth. And so I'm just trying to filter it and come to an understanding of it. And something that I do believe is that I think just having coming off the cusp of a lot of Black Lives Matter issues, which, you know, a lot of the things that what Black Lives Matter stands for, I don't agree with, you know, promoting the violence and the things that they've done, to basically, as you said, to have a holiday that now I think divides more than unites. Obviously, getting rid of slavery was incredible. And what so one question I have is, why couldn't we just make Emancipation Day a bigger thing? Why did we have to, in the year, you know, I from what I researched, 2015 might have been one of the first celebrations of Juneteenth. Now that word. Now, I know that Juneteenth is a celebration of the anniversary of what you just said, what happened in Texas, I think it was 1863, you know, when finally the people in Texas heard what had happened of the signing on January 1st. So they were a little bit late, you know, in getting the news, and that's a great thing. But I think that the news is that slaves are free, which came from the emancipation. Or maybe, I don't know, your other guest said that that only had to do with the Confederate state, not the Union states. That might have something to do with it. But,
well,
again, I just don't...
Go ahead. Yes.
I just don't think that church is, like I said, we need holidays that are uniting. We need to celebrate every race, I feel, because there's a lot of division. And I think that that's what, I mean, all of a sudden from, like I said, I have not heard the word before this year. Okay, it was around, great. But to make it a federal holiday, there's only, what, 10 states in the country that are jumping on to making this a holiday where the states are going to give the day off. I mean, it's kind of like, you know, it's something new that all of a sudden, here you go, there it is, accept it, and that's the end. And I think that if you're going to do something like that, make it for something that unites all the cultures, all the races.
I got you, Carol, but I don't know. Could I just get a clarification from you? Because the thing that seems divisive to you about it is that it's associated with the Black Lives Matter protests?
No, I think it's just that I want to begin hearing about, you know, I see signs, you know, Black Lives Matter. I see the LGBTH flag, and I think it divides this country. I think we need to start promoting things that unite, because obviously those are hot topics, you know, and people either stand one way or the other. And I think that we need to unite.
I agree with you. I don't disagree with you at all. I also kind of agree with the thing you said about celebrating all races. I mean, I think I don't understand how we don't have a holiday for Native Americans. And then people say, well, it should be Columbus Day. Well, why don't we let Native American people pick a day that's important to them? Because it seems to me that Juneteenth is a day that's important to African Americans. They picked it. It's their day. It's the day that they celebrated. So now the country gets in on that celebration. But I like, holidays actually haven't always united. Labor Day was not a uniting holiday.
Well, Martin Luther King Day was very divisive when it was first proposed.
Yeah, I suppose, right. Mostly, I mean, in Arizona.
Even something like President's Day, where to celebrate Abraham Lincoln in many parts of the country was controversial.
Right.
So it'd be hard to find certainly a national holiday.
But I'm struggling a little bit, Carol, with what exactly is the I guess the reason that I think Juneteenth is good is that it doesn't seem divisive to me. I don't feel like it's a Black Lives Matter thing.
I don't think
thing.
There's a strong anti-emancipation.
It just seems like a great
block.
Thing to celebrate.
It is a great thing to celebrate, and I agree. But I think attention needs to be put to areas that we can call ourselves, bring us all under, like, humankind. You know, I'm sure there are things that we can be more united with, but also not just that, how much I agree or if they could change it a little bit. It's more that, as you said, President's Day was divisive. Martin Luther King Day was divisive. Let's not bring it to church.
Well, okay, so I think I see.
Until people understand it better, you know, and until, or, you know what I'm saying? And especially because at church I'm hearing about Juneteenth, but I hear absolutely nothing about politicians who are being allowed to go to communion and how that really shouldn't be allowed. Or how, hey guys, hey folks, you know, we're going to be voting, you know, this coming up week. Please remember, not naming any politician at all, please remember your duty as a Catholic to not vote for pro-choice candidates. I don't hear that. They don't want to step on those toes, but they're okay with things that are just up and coming. These, you know what I'm saying? It's like,
I do, Carol, but I can't say that I share that impression about Juneteenth.
Well,
but,
I mean, we
but
had
I could be
Juneteenth
missing
celebrations
it.
When I was growing up, but partly it's regional. I mean, I grew up in kind of an African-American area in Kansas City. If you're up in New England where Juneteenth may not have been as deeply rooted, it probably does seem newer. The first Juneteenth celebration was in 1866, so it's not new in that sense. It was a Texas holiday from 1938. So it's in the South and kind of moving north. Juneteenth has been a big celebration. And one of the ways it's been described is America's Second Independence Day. And the idea being that the promises made back in 1776 and in 1789 were now true for black people as well as for white people. And so in that sense, it does seem very much like what you're wanting, everyone just being treated the same. Well, Juneteenth is the celebration of that actually becoming truer.
But if I may say, like, so President Joe Biden, he makes this I don't know if it was an act of Congress or what, but I have to say, you know, the this is obviously political pandering, and what there's always that when you make a new holiday. At a certain point, you just kind of got to go, I don't care about that. I mean, sure, the politicians are just trying to make their political points, and they have their venal reasons to do what they do, but is what they did good or bad? That's what I end up with. And I think it's good for two reasons. One, we needed a holiday in June. And I'm dead serious about that. I think holidays are good. And two, if you're going to have one, Juneteenth is a great day.
Yeah.
I don't know, Carol, I'm not trying to talk over you, though. Like, I wanted to
speak to one half of the question we haven't even gotten to yet, which is what about the church's role? Because even if we can say this is a good thing for the state to have as a holiday, but what should the church be doing? And I think that, as she said, a lot of people don't understand Juneteenth or think about it in terms of these, like, Black Lives Matter kind of terms, in terms of modern race-based politics. And it's better for the church to really say, no, this is a Catholic issue. This is a Christian issue. And here I'd point to paragraph 2414 of the Catechism. I'm just going to read it. The seventh commandment forbids acts or enterprises that for any reason, selfish or ideological, commercial or totalitarian, lead to the enslavement of human beings, to their being bought, sold, and exchanged like merchandise, in disregard for their personal dignity. It is a sin against the dignity of persons and their fundamental rights to reduce them by violence to their productive value or to a source of profit. St. Paul directed a Christian master to treat his Christian slave no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, as a beloved brother, both in the flesh and in the Lord. And the reference there is to the Epistle of Philemon, that he's writing on behalf of Philemon to argue for his emancipation, to argue for his freedom. And so, just like all Christians should be united against the horrible abuse against the unborn, all Christians, even though it's like, oh, it's a political issue, all Christians should be united against racial enslavement, any kind of enslavement. And we are hidebound if we take St. Paul seriously and if we take the Catechism seriously to have that position. So in that sense, like, emancipation, whatever you may think about the ins and outs, the particulars of the Civil War and the way it was fought and et cetera, emancipation was an undeniable, undoubted good that there aren't two possible Christian positions on. So in that sense, Juneteenth is celebrating something that was an untarnished good that I think all of us should proclaim from the pulpit and from the pew and be something we rejoice in.
All right, Kara, I'm going to give you the last word because my concern is that I might be missing something that you're saying because it does seem to me that this seems more divisive to you than it feels to me, and I might be missing some. Go ahead, Carol.
But I just, like I said, I know that there have been other cultures that have suffered in this country, the Irish and the Italians when they came over, the Jews, and that's all is that I would like us to unite under one holiday, all of us. The freedom, as you say, you know, that belongs to every human being, freedom and dignity of life, that I just wish that we could, you know, maybe the next holiday will be something like that. And because it definitely is, emancipation is definitely something that we need to celebrate. And I agree. I would like to see something, maybe the next holiday, something that unites all of us. And that's what I would love to see. But I will take that, you know, like I said, and I agree with the last few things you've said, I'll open my eyes and take it to Jesus and seeing it for what it is. Hopefully it won't divide us more, and maybe the next holiday will include everybody.
Boy, you are a lovely caller, Carol. Thanks very much. I really appreciate that call. And the opportunity to talk about Juneteenth. I did want to do that today, and I'm glad we got the opportunity. Anyone's welcome to call because it's open forum, 888-318-7884. I never did the break? What? Do I have to do the break now? Okay, we'll be right back.
Let us help you with your question today on Catholic Answers Live.
We have a big problem. Our culture is dying, and souls are in danger of being lost. The answer is conversion to Jesus Christ in His church. St. Paul Street Evangelization is a Catholic organization, and we have hundreds of teams spreading the good news throughout the country. But we need your help. The harvest is great, but the laborers are few. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
St. Hildegard of Bingen was a mystic, an abbess, a botanist, a saint, and a doctor of the church.
Matthew Bunsen and the Doctors of the Church.
Hildegard had her first visions at the age of three, which she called the shade of the living light. She later wrote about them in works declared by St. Bernard of Clairvaux to be from God. Pope Benedict XVI agreed when he named her only one of four Doctors of the Church who are women in 2012.
For more about the Doctors of the Church, visit doctorsofthechurch.com.
Welcome back, Catholic Answers Live. Joe Heschmeyer, our guest. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. It's open forum. The number 888-318-7884. Because of the time, Joe, I think I'm just going to go right back to the phones and we'll let you talk to some
Please.
Folks. All right, let's go to Robert in Missouri, listening on the Covenant Radio Network. Glad to have you, Robert. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
Thank you. So good to get through you. I haven't called for 2 months, it seems. Anyway, to get to the question, the church in scripture, New Testament, is described as Christ's body and also his bride. Now, how does that relate to the marriage of the Lamb and his bride, which is described in the book of Revelations as the New Jerusalem? Was one written before or after, or how do they relate, sir?
That's a great question. I like how succinctly you put that question, too.
Thank you, Robert.
Yeah. Those are all different ways of describing the same hard-to-describe reality. And so even if you look at Ephesians 5, Jesus is going to say the church is the bride of Christ, and then he says the church is the body of Christ. Now, neither of those metaphors exhausts the truth, or he wouldn't have the other one. And yet they're hard to kind of square. How could it be both his body and his bride? Well, New Jerusalem, we can add to that list of getting to the truth, but in this way if you take all the metaphors very literally, it's hard to kind of square. So St. Paul explains this a little bit in Romans 11 with yet another image, this time of a wild olive shoot. And he describes Israel as a wild olive shoot, and some of the unbelieving branches were broken off, and then some foreign branches were grafted in. These foreign branches being the Gentile believers. And so what you have is not the replacement of Israel. You know, when we talk about the New Jerusalem, we don't mean God got rid of the Jews as his chosen people, God got rid of Jerusalem. No, we don't mean that. We mean that there's a reorganization of the people of God, that he draws together the faithful, whether Jew or Gentile, and he brings the Gentiles into what he's already begun with the Jews. And that's what he means by the church. It's the ecclesia, the assembly, the gathering together. And that reorganization is also what's meant by calling the church the New Jerusalem. And the danger of even saying New Jerusalem is it sounds like we mean a totally second, like separate Jerusalem. It's just the reorganized Jerusalem. It's the people of God rearranged to include faithful Gentiles and with the non-believers kind of having broken off from it. Does that make sense? Does that harmonize those images for you?
That's great. Thank you very much.
Oh, thank you. What a very pleasant call. Well, we're having lots of nice calls today.
Yeah. I think we could do the call on line five quickly if you want to, just because I feel bad because there's such a short time in between breaks.
Okay.
That it feels bad to only take one call and then have more commercials.
Okay, so let's go to line five, and that is Dylan in California. Go ahead, Dylan, with your question.
Hi. So I have this ongoing search I've been on for a long time now, and that's finding like the right Catholic Bible to really put my mind and like my prayer life into. Mm-hmm. And I've really distilled it down to either the Revised Standard Version Catholic Edition or the New American Bible Revised Edition. So,
so you want Joe to settle it?
A lot of fun. Sure, yeah.
Joe, settle it.
Yeah, actually, my friend and colleague, Trent Horn, has a really good clip called Cringy Notes in the Catholic New American Bible. And long story short, the New American Bible was created. The New Testament was overseen by one Cardinal McCarrick of ignominy, now Mr. McCarrick. And it was supposed to be the latest and greatest critical scholarship and a liturgical Bible and a Bible ordinary people could use. And if you understand anything about Bible translation and footnotes, those should have been three different Bibles. It was a bad project from the beginning. But the footnotes in the NAB are bad and in some cases heretical. So I'd point you to Trent's thing, Cringy Notes in the Catholic New American Bible, and say positively that the RSV CE, the Revised Standard Version Catholic Edition, is a beautiful Bible, very well rendered, and I use it as my personal go-to translation.
All right. Thanks very much. I appreciate how quickly you got to the question, Joe. I appreciate how quickly you did the answer. And now we will take a very brief break, and we'll be right back with more Open Forum. There's three lines open, so perfect time to call, 888-318-7884. You want to talk about Juneteenth? You want to talk about sacraments, Jesus, Catholic Church? Whether you're Catholic or not, you're welcome to call, 888-318-7884. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. Still happy to be here on a Monday. It's always so nice to get back here in front of these microphones and get to talk with folks. And thank you to everybody who has called. And I know there's lots of folks waiting on the line. It's open forum. The number is 888-318-7884. Celebrating the newest federal holiday in the United States here called Juneteenth. We talked about a little bit about that last hour. But we don't get these holidays off. As a matter of fact, if you get the holiday off, see, this is why we don't we're often here on these federal holidays, is we want to hook you. We're like, well, maybe there's listeners who don't get to listen most days because they're working on this day, and now they got the day off, and they turn the radio station on, and they're like, what is this? So you can find out about
quit your job so you can listen to Catholic Answers.
Yes, that's right. Just quit or just quit for a couple hours each day. You can find out about what we do at Catholic.com. And this is Catholic Answers Live that you're listening to. Joe Heschmeyer is our guest. It's open forum. Joe, thank you for returning for another hour.
My pleasure.
The number is 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. I have to say, though, after we talked with Carol in Massachusetts about Juneteenth, I think there's another thing that I have that I think it's very un-American, but I believe in holidays. I believe in days off. I think, like, federal holidays and state holidays are a way to share the prosperity of a society with the working class who don't get a lot of days off. I think this is a good, like, I know that that's, I think, like, in the Middle Ages, when you read about how they lived in the Middle Ages.
They had so many days off. It was amazing.
They had way more days off than we have. People think, oh, the drudgery of the Middle Ages. They didn't go on vacations. They had festivals. There was a different kind of society, right? They didn't go on vacations. But festivals would go on for days sometimes. So I, as a Catholic, I am a full believer in holidays. I think we need more holidays, not fewer holidays. I think particularly for those who are working people who don't have, maybe their job doesn't even provide them with vacation days. Many jobs don't. Like a home health care worker or whatnot. That person doesn't get days off in many cases. So I think I'm a big believer. So if you want to talk about that too, you know, because some people are just resent that there's another federal holiday. They're like, oh, another holiday for the lazy Americans. America, I think we work more than any other people on earth. I think we're like the.
I'm not sure we work more than any
I'm not
other
saying
people
that
on earth.
I do.
No,
I'm
saying, no one. No one is saying.
I was
that you
using
do.
The collective there.
But certainly in terms of hours per week, we do rank pretty badly. There are other countries that do a really bad job of taking time off as well.
Yeah. But then you hear about these, you know, like, oh, these countries that we look down on. Oh, they're always taking days off. You know, the other thing that Catholic countries, I believe that it was Catholic countries that invented it. As a matter of fact, I think it was Spain that invented this, but maybe not. Siesta. Are you kidding me? That's the greatest invention. That's the worst thing that society ever got rid of. Like, are you with me, Edgar, on this? Are you with me on siesta? It's not a racial thing. That's not why I'm asking you, Edgar. I'm just saying that
this is going downhill. Let's go to callers.
No,
before Cy gives his opinion about all other.
No. In Mexico, there was a history of siesta, and they're losing it because they're becoming more like us. Instead of us becoming more like them, we should learn from Mexico.
I mean, I was in Italy, and likewise, the siesta is unfortunately going by the wayside.
Sorry, Edgar. I feel bad now.
Edgar.
I was just because you know a lot about Mexican
Edgar
culture.
Edgar is from California.
But California, for Edgar, is Mexico. Like, you know, this belongs to Mexico, Edgar. You know it does. We stole it.
So, online.
888. 318-780. Would you want to go back to the phones, or do you want to say something about my theory of holidays?
More is better. I'm waiting to see what they type in the.
Wait, did you just type that? That's the. Oh, you can spell that word. Daniel in North Carolina watching on. Wait, what number is Daniel on?
Line one. Daniel in North Carolina.
On line one, you're numero uno this hour, Daniel. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
Hey, Joe, huge fan of the show. Hey, so I participated in my diocese synod of synodality a couple months ago, and it was kind of a crap show. I'm on the younger
wait
side.
Wait a second. Hang on. Wait. Were they playing the game of crabs, or were you just saying something that you should not say on the radio? I want to know. Were there dice there?
Okay, then
don't say that word.
Thank you.
Use a different word.
Thank you.
Okay, go ahead.
Crazy. And and I was expecting going in, you know, obviously you see on the news, like with Germany and Italy and stuff like that. And I was like, oh, it shouldn't be that bad. And it was pretty bad. And I thought for the most, both with LGBTQ, women ordination, I brought up the CDF from Pope Francis. They didn't care. Now, to this past week, what happened was is that they had the final discussion with our bishop there. And what happened was is that there was a little bit of a summary before the final document has been released. And obviously Bishop Jugas or any bishop is going to finish it. But what's going to happen, but what we kind of, I had friends who were there and participated in that, saying that only like 1 or 2%, like very small percent of even like just moderate conservative, not even like TLM, you know, traditionalists were really that representative. But the vast majority of the people there were saying we want women ordination, gay marriage, and stuff like that. And so my question is it really, is gay marriage in the church sense and women ordination really an infallible teaching that's set in stone and these people are just kind of almost kind of moving up against a brick wall that shouldn't move, or is this can actually change?
That's a great question. And the answer is brick wall. And so it's probably good for bishops to know that people in their diocese are this poorly formed and that their minds are this far apart from the teaching of the church, because it points to a real evangelical and catechetical crisis, that people don't understand the basics of Christianity. I know that's putting it very harshly in one way, but if you read what the church says on these topics, there's no ambiguity. The CDF, in response just to blessing same-sex unions, says this. The church recalls, the CDF is a doctrinal wing of the Vatican. Like it gets into issues of doctrine and faith. The church recalls that God himself never ceases to bless each of his pilgrim children in this world, because for him we are more important to God than all of the sins that we can commit. But he does not and cannot bless sin. He blesses sinful man so that he may recognize that he's part of his plan of love and allow himself to be changed by him. He, in fact, takes us as we are, but he never leaves us as we are. For the above-mentioned reasons, the church does not have and cannot have the power to bless unions of persons of the same sex in the sense intended above. In other words, you can give blessings to individuals who might be in irregular relationships. You can't bless the relationship itself because the relationship is sinful, and God does not and cannot bless sin, and so the church does not and cannot bless sin. That's about as strong as you can get. That not only are we bound by it, but in some sense, God himself is bound by it, because sin by its nature is contrary to the will of God. And so God cannot be God while both affirming and denying the same thing. He cannot be God while affirming and rejecting sin. And so in that sense, like it would be hard to find a much stronger kind of rejection of the idea. That's on same-sex unions. Not even marriage, just same-sex unions. The church can't bless them. But then on women's ordination, St. John Paul II says this, "Wherefore, in order that all doubt may be removed regarding a matter of great importance, a matter which pertains to the Church's divine constitution itself, in virtue of my ministry of confirming the brethren, I declare that the Church has no authority whatsoever to confer priestly ordination on women, and that this judgment is to be definitively held by all the Church's faithful." In other words, one, the Church cannot ordain women because Christ didn't leave that power. Two, this is something that all Catholics need to believe in. And so when you have a big group of Catholics saying, we don't believe in this, we think the church should change her teaching, they're revealing they don't believe what the church teaches, and they don't understand the way church teaching works, and they don't understand the relationship of church teaching to the teachings and ministry of Jesus Christ. That we can't just say, well, here's what we wish Jesus would have done, so we can get more with the times. That's not how Christianity works. That's why I say there's a basic failure to understand Christianity. This points to a real evangelical crisis. Now, some people, they just haven't heard these things. Other people have heard them and reject them. But either way, we have a crisis on our hands that people need to know and believe the things that I just shared, and that sounds like the things that you're concerned about, that you're worried about. What are your thoughts about that?
You know, no, that's great. Like I said, I think the big thing, and it's just, I think the big thing is just like, I'm kind of shocked of, you know, kind of seeing that firsthand. And, you know, you know, just a lot of prayer, praying for my bishop, that everything kind of, that they stay strong and stuff like that without kind of putting pressure. And maybe this is more of an opportunity for me to go to Holy Hour and pray those things and to kind of view it in an absolute negative sight.
Amen. Well, I just echo also, like, I'm glad you're involved in the synodal process, because I think a lot of people hear like a synod on synodality and they just kind of laugh at it and they're not involved and those voices aren't represented. And then the people who are, you know, maybe more activist and want to change Catholic teaching, want the Catholic Church to believe different things than the Catholic Church believes, they have every reason to show up. Whereas if you're just saying, no, I think we should keep believing what we believe, we should maybe do a better job of presenting it, but it's, you know, it's less attractive to maybe be involved in these often frustrating synodal processes. But I'm glad you're doing it, because if you don't do it, if people like you don't do it, then the voices of orthodoxy and the voices really of sanity don't get represented.
Daniel, thanks very, very much. I've been doing a bad job of taking the breaks today, so I'm going to take that break, and we'll be right back with more Open Forum with Joe Heschmeyer on Catholic Answers Live.
There's only one Catholic Answers Live.
Are you a coffee drinker? If so, you can now enjoy a coffee roasted to perfection by the Carmelite Monks of Wyoming. Delicious Mystic Monk coffee is roasted and prepared by monks in a hidden cloistered monastery and is available in over 25 varieties. All Mystic Monk coffees are works of perfection and labors of love. For more information on how to purchase Mystic Monk coffee, visit mysticmonkcoffee.com. That's mysticmonkcoffee.com.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
This is Dr. Ray Guarendi from The Doctor Is In. You call in and we will talk about what matters to you in your life. We can put our heads together to help you solve the problems of life and to use your faith to get even smarter.
The Doctor Is In with Dr. Ray Guarendi. Tomorrow afternoon, 1 Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live. Joe Heschmeyer, our guest. It's kind of a bonus open forum on a Monday, but generally speaking, a bonus forum, not bonus open forum, but any open forum is an opportunity to have a lot of fun. We get to have all kinds of great conversations on just about anything. So that continues. But before we go back to the phones, Joe, I did want to mention that we have a big conference coming up in September.
We do?
Because I am obligated contractually to mention this when they tell me to, and that people can save $50 on their ticket right now by using the promo code EARLY when they go to CatholicAnswersConference.com. And that promo code works until July 1st. So, and I have to say this loudly because, see, on the script, they put 3 exclamation points.
Don't procrastinate.
Okay, thank you, Joe, for helping me do that.
Yep, you bet.
Catholic Answers Conference coming up last weekend of September, September 22nd through 25th here in beautiful, sunny San Diego. And the deal on the hotel rooms is fantastic. It'll be at the Hyatt over in La Jolla. And, Joe, you're going to talk.
I am.
Give a talk.
I'm going to be looking at the connection between the Eucharist and eternal life.
Particularly, it's a pretty solid connection.
Yeah, yeah.
According to the Lord.
And it is. But like, why is bodily resurrection connected in the Church Fathers and in Jesus and in St. Paul with the Eucharist? So
it's a whole conference on the Eucharist, and you're just going to love it. Plus, if you sign up now, those who register for the conference will get an autographed copy of Trent's brand new book, Devil's Advocate, Facing My Inner Anti-Catholic, just out, as a matter of fact, just some of the copy of it not too long ago. So head over to CatholicAnswersConference.com, put in that promo code EARLY, save $50, and come hang out with us. We're going to have a great time and learn lots and lots and lots about the Eucharist that last weekend in September. All right, let's go to McAllen, Texas, listening to EWTN on Channel 130, Sirius XM Satellite Radio. Alfredo in McAllen, Texas. We're glad you're here, Alfredo. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
Yes, thank you. This is my first time. My question is, was the public school system invented by the Catholic Church? If so, where can I read more about it?
That's a great question. The Catholic Encyclopedia has an article. So it's an encyclopedia. So the article is just literally entitled Schools. And it traces the kind of complicated history. I'll give the short version, but I'm not going to do justice to the whole thing. Before Christianity, education was basically for rich people and rulers. So like even the phrase liberal arts refers to the fact that you're free, like not a slave. And so it was not something for everybody. After the introduction of Christianity, there was this real sense originally that we needed religious formation for priests, and not just religious formation, but we needed formation in the other things as well, grammar, rhetoric, all that stuff. And also for monks and nuns, basically. But then from there, probably somewhere around the 8th century, this really kind of spread, and not everywhere all at once, but spread on kind of a case-by-case basis to including forming not only the clergy, but also the laity, because it was like, well, they also need to know religious instruction. Now, this would still be men, but it'd be formation in grammar, logic, rhetoric, reading, writing, and arithmetic, or arithmetic, astronomy, music, and geometry, what was called the trivium and quadrivium. So seven subjects that you learned that were supposed to like basically prepare you for philosophy and theology, that a laity that doesn't understand the basics of logic doesn't understand the way a religious argument works. And so there was a religious duty to do this. And so there was a council in Rome in 853 that talks about the need in every diocese to kind of minister to the population subject to them. And so there really was this kind of trickling down that bishops should make sure the priests are well-informed and the priest should make sure that the people in his parish are well-informed. And so it certainly seems that that was kind of uneven and kind of how well that was executed around the church. But you really have an earnest effort to create what we would now recognize as basically a public school system open to ordinary people, not just for those who were on track to be politicians or clergy or anything of the like.
Alfredo, what do you think?
Awesome, awesome. Thank you. Yes, I'm going to read more about it on the encyclopedia, and I just have that interest right now.
Learning more
about it.
Yeah, I think it's something that our own Chris Check talks about sometimes. So I bet he would be a good guy to tap about that as well.
In the United States, there's a history of public school being anti-Catholic, which is a different history.
Although it's really fascinating because when you look at what the controversies were, we would take those controversies today. So, for instance, one of the controversies was they prayed the Lord's Prayer in public school, but they did the Protestant version with "Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever" at the end. Mm-hmm. And we were like, well, I'll do the Catholic version. And sometimes I think it was much more like openly bigoted. But in some of the cases, it really was like they're doing the KJV instead of the Douay Rheims. And like they're doing a different version of the Bible than we use. Whereas now you go into a public school and they're not, we'll just say they're not using the Bible at all.
But there is the famous case of Pierce versus the Sisters in Oregon, 1925. Yes. Where they basically tried to shut down Catholic schools in Oregon and make everyone go to public school so that Catholics would be less Catholic.
And that was often pretty explicitly the intention of, like, we're going to indoctrinate you to be a good believing Protestant.
Alfredo, it was, for a first call, that was a really good one. You think you'll do it again?
Yes, we'll do. Thank you.
Okay. I missed what he said.
I didn't hear it either.
Oh, I missed it, but he said thank you. All right. All right. Peace, brother. Hope we'll get to talk with you again. Roberto in Michigan, listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. Welcome, Roberto. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
Hello, guys. My question is, a little bit of a background first. I was messaged on Facebook Messenger by a Mormon missionary, and you know, we got to some talking about our faith, and I explained pretty quickly early on that I'm Catholic, you know, just out of respect for this man's time. And he invited me to have a conversation with him on the phone regarding our different faiths and to share information about them. And I just wanted to know how to approach this and how can I be the best representative of Catholicism possible, and also what doctrines and things should I focus on with in our conversation.
That's a great question.
That's my question.
I have a little bit of a history doing this. Back in 2011, I guess, there were some LDS missionaries that their headquarters was not far from some good friends, and so we'd have them over for dinner. And I can say in the accumulation of a fair amount of experience, number one, pray for them, because prayer is the most powerful and effective weapon. Number two, they will probably be extremely nice. And if you're a jerk, you've already lost. Number three, they often kind of deflect substantive criticisms by saying things like, oh, you know, just pray about it and see if it's true. And so there's not a good integration of faith and reason the way that we have, you know, in Catholicism. Fides et Ratio talks about faith and reason as the two wings on which the human spirit rises. There's this notion truth can't contradict truth. So you never have to just suspend all thought and reason in order for faith to work. You don't have to just put tough things on the shelf. You will find a little bit of what's sometimes called fideism in talking about some of the difficulties with LDS theology. And fourth, I would say you probably, in terms of subject matter, watch out for proof text and look for areas that you can build on common ground. So in terms of watching out for proof text, one of the big issues is what's called the total apostasy. The LDS believe that true Christianity was wiped off the face of the earth almost immediately after the first apostles. And they will point to texts like Amos 9. But if you look at Amos 8, verses 9 to 12, if you look at it, they're taking it totally out of context. And the next chapter talks about how a remnant will remain. And so it was not about the entire people going into apostasy. And so those kind of texts, I'd just say be prepared for some of those. There tends to be a bit of common ground. Both recognize it's important that Jesus establishes a church and a priesthood, and either the gates of hell immediately overcame the church, which Mormons believe, or they didn't, which is what Jesus says is going to happen in Matthew 16. Now, and finally, I'd just say like a few areas to touch on, certainly that issue of apostasy versus apostolic succession. I like talking about abortion with LDS missionaries because it's something on which we're basically in agreement that abortion is murder. It's wrong. But then you read from the official LDS website and it says, church leaders have said that some exceptional circumstances may justify an abortion, such as when pregnancy is a result of incest or rape. And so even apart from life and health of the mother, there's a broad set of categories that a Mormon bishop can authorize abortion, even though the LDS church teaches that abortion is murder. So sometimes murder is okay if your bishop says so. Most LDS don't know that's the teaching of their church. And when you point that out, that's a really big one. There are a lot of other areas like that. There are a lot of like pretty blatant contradictions, but on, for instance, the issues of plural marriage, the LDS church has gone back and forth on whether this is good or bad, and some of the contradictions are particularly flagrant. But I would just point that out, and I'm saying all of these things present the truth with love. You don't have to know all the ins and outs of Mormon theology. If Jesus really did found the Catholic Church, and if the Catholic Church really didn't immediately apostatize, which Christ promises it won't, he promises to send the Holy Spirit to lead the church into all truth, then we don't have to ask if some other church is true if it's built on the idea that the church did what Jesus said the church wouldn't do, namely apostatize. Does that help? Does that make sense?
Oh, that helps a lot. Thank you for that answer.
Okay. I would also suggest if you just look up Patrick Madrid and Mormonism or Latter-day Saints, he really is one of the best on, he's just done a lot of the research, had a lot of the dialogues, and he's got lots of great material. So Patrick Madrid, who, one of the founders of Catholic Answers here. Okay, Roberto?
Okay. I love your answers. I'll definitely use that.
Okay. All right. Thanks, great. Roberto. Where are we going now? The number is 888-318-7884. It's open forum, and our guest is Joe Heschmeyer. We're going back to Texas, Houston, Texas. Antonio in Houston, Texas, watching on YouTube. Antonio, we're glad you're here. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
Good afternoon, guys. Thank you for taking my call. Hello?
Oh, well, yeah. Oh, sorry, Antonio.
I didn't want to interrupt you. I thought you were about to keep going. But
we're both waiting.
Sorry, yes.
Hello?
Sorry, that was rude.
Okay, sir. My question, sir, is on Matthew or Mark on the death of Jesus Christ. What mm-hmm. is the significance of, when Jesus died, the curtain on hanging on the temple was split mm-hmm. into two from top to bottom?
Yeah.
What is the significance of that veil being torn in between? Because the answer that I got from a friend of mine is that when that veil was torn into two, it means that we don't need the priest no more. No, you can go to God directly. You don't need the priest, you know, you don't have to. There's no more middleman to go to God. I think that's what we,
that's a very common interpretation.
Could you give me some enlightenment on that one, sir?
Yeah, so let's. I wanted to address kind of the false version that you got from your friend first, and then give what the Bible actually says. So in Matthew 6, Jesus talks about, you know what? We're going to get back after this break. Sorry.
Can you hang on, Antonio?
Sure.
Okay.
Hang on.
Yeah, please hang on. We got to take this quick break. We'll be right back with more Open Forum with Joe Heschmeyer on Catholic Answers Live.
This is Archbishop Salvatore Cordiglione of San Francisco. Thank you for listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Did you know you can access Catholic Answers Live right from your phone or other mobile device? Download the Catholic Answers Live app today. The Catholic Answers Live app, available now on iOS and Android.
Have you enrolled in the Catholic Answers School of Apologetics? Let me ask you a more important question. Do you believe as a Catholic that you have an obligation to share the Catholic faith? In fact, the Church has answered this question, and the answer is that all confirmed Catholics are obliged to share the faith. It's actually in canon law. Catholic Answers is here to help you fulfill that obligation. Our School of Apologetics courses will equip you to help all the people you come in contact with understand what the Church teaches and why. A great place to start is with all the Catholics in your life. Learn the art of apologetics from the best of the best and start sharing the gospel today. Visit schoolofapologetics.com. That's schoolofapologetics.com.
Most of us Catholic parents agree our number one goal in life is to pass on the faith to our children. But here's the bad news. Today's world has a million ways to steal your kid's soul. Don't be afraid, says Father Sebastian Walsh. God loves your children even more than you do, and he desires their salvation more than anything. In his groundbreaking new book, Always a Catholic, Father Walsh shows you how to cooperate with God to bring about the fulfillment of his will for your kids. Always a Catholic reminds us that keeping our kids in the faith is about the way we live our Catholicism in our own lives and as a family from day to day. Order your copy of Always a Catholic by visiting shop.catholic.com today or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Tomorrow on Mortal Life, the life you were meant to live.
We'll look at how the theology of the body can help you live a more abundant life.
That's tomorrow on Mortal Life, 10 a.m. Eastern, 9 Central on EWTN Radio.
Now back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live. Antonio on the line from Houston, or as General Zod says, Houston. You don't get the reference?
I don't get the reference. Is that Superman?
Yeah, Superman.
I've never seen it.
Antonio, with a very fine question about the meaning of the tearing of the curtain in the temple in Jerusalem at the death of Jesus. And you were just about to commence an answer, and we had to go.
Yes. So his friend had suggested that the tearing of the temple means, oh, look, you don't have to go to a priest anymore. The priesthood's gone. You can go directly to Jesus. Now, this gets everything theologically wrong. The first thing that gets theologically wrong is the idea you couldn't go directly to God before. And that's just not true. The Pharisees would regularly pray to God. We see that in the example of the Pharisee and the tax collector. They're both in the synagogue trying to pray to God. Now, the Pharisee's praying to himself because of his narcissism, not because he needs to be going to the priest. In Matthew 6, Jesus says that when you pray, don't be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners that they may be seen by men. In other words, no Jew, Pharisee, Sadducee, a follower of Jesus, whoever you want, no Jew thought you had to go to the priest to pray to God. That's just like a total Protestant myth. That's the first thing. What you did have to go to the priest for was sacrifice, that there is an element of sacrifice that only the priests and Levites can offer, sacrificial worship. And Jesus talks about this with the Samaritan woman in John 4, how that'll be offered in spirit and truth. That doesn't just mean by anyone and everyone wherever. Rather, Malachi 1:11 says this will be offered around the whole world. And in Isaiah 66, there's a promise that sacrifice will be offered up by some of the new believers. So in Isaiah 66, there's a prophecy about the new covenant, how the Gentiles will be incorporated. In Isaiah 66, verse 21, it says of these new Gentile converts, some of them also I will take for priests and for Levites, says the Lord. So that's explicitly telling us that the new covenant is going to have priests in it, and then it won't be just everyone. So we know that the Protestant interpretation, that the tearing of the temple means that you're getting rid of the priest, or the tearing of the curtain means you're getting rid of the priesthood, is just not true, because it presupposes, one, you couldn't pray to God directly before when you could, and two, that it gets rid of the priesthood in the New Covenant when the New Testament and the Old Testament both are clear that there will be priests in the New Covenant. So what is it instead? Oh, sorry.
No, I was just going to check in back in with Antonio, and see what he thought, but you can go ahead. You can finish if you want.
Okay, well, I was just going to say, what is it instead? And we're given an actual answer to that in the Epistle to the Hebrews. So in Hebrews 10, it says in verse 19, therefore, brethren, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way, which he opened for us through the curtain that is through his flesh, and since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith. In other words, the tearing of the temple represents the tearing of the body of Jesus. That's what Hebrews 10 tells us, that the curtain is a representation of his flesh. In John 2, Jesus describes himself as the new temple and says, destroy this temple and in 3 days I'll rebuild it. And so the tearing of the curtain shows this connection between the Old Testament temple and the New Testament body of Christ, because the tearing of the flesh and the tearing of the curtain. That's the actual biblical answer to the question, what does the tearing represent? It may have other meanings as well, but the fact that the standard Protestant interpretation doesn't even acknowledge the answer given in the Bible seems to me a striking omission.
Now, Antonio, what do you think of that?
Very good, sir. Thank you so much for that answer. I think I'm a little enlightened on that one.
Oh, good.
Actually, it's a question that long years that I've been asking that. So thank you for the enlightenment.
Oh, that was very nice. Good, long yeah, years and some satisfaction from
that. That always feels good when people say that. So
thanks, Antonio. I'm going to go to Ahmed in South Dakota, listening on 91.3 FM. Ahmed, you there with us?
Oh, yes, I am. Hello, sir.
Hello. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
So I'm non-Catholic, and I have a couple questions about Christianity. So one of my dad's friends, he went to college at SDSU, South Dakota State University.
Yep.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm not listening.
Did we lose you? Wait, what happened here? All right. Ahmed, you still there with us? Cause I can give you a minute and come back. All right. Will you talk to Ahmed? Thanks, Edgar. And then we'll come back to him. It sounded like he's still there. Maybe he just dropped the phone. Well, let's go to Walt in Coatesville, Pennsylvania, listening on the TuneIn app. Walt, we're glad you're here. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
So, Joe, I wanted to say that there was a woman called up earlier, and she was concerned about Juneteenth mm-hmm. being a day where people were divided. And I was thinking, I think it's a good thing to celebrate the Juneteenth holiday, but I think it could be misused. And this is what I mean. There's this narrative that only white people own slaves. It's false. But even in the United States, even black people own slaves. Also, that white people went into Africa and stole slaves away in the from the jungles and their homes. That's false, too. Black people who had gone to war with others, who had conquered, brought those slaves to the coast and sold them to white people. Of course, none of this is right. It's just I think it's important to set the record straight, because the narrative has been bad white people took these people from their home, and they're the only ones that are guilty of this sin. And it's just not true. And I think that's one of the problems with the bad history that we've been getting for centuries, well, at least the last century, in the United States.
Yeah, I think there obviously there was a color dimension to slavery, right? Like there was race-based chattel slavery, but you're absolutely right that there were white and black slave owners,
and Native American slave owners,
right? And there were white and black abolitionists. There were white and black people involved in the slave trade in Africa as well as in America, and so yeah, we can acknowledge both. This was an explicitly racist system. Like if we say slavery in the U.S. wasn't racist, it would be hard to imagine anything that is, because it was explicitly and intentionally and obviously racist. But it wasn't simply that all whites were bad and all blacks were good, even on this issue. That there were corrupt people on both sides of the color line. There were good people on both sides of the color line. I think the important takeaway for something like should we celebrate Juneteenth as Catholics is this is a Catholic issue. Our allegiance is not first and foremost to our skin color. We're warned against that by Pope Pius XI and Mit Brinder Zorge, that you don't want to make race an idol. Your allegiance is to Christ. And so first and foremost, it's what do I believe as a Catholic about slavery? Not what did my ancestors do or what did people who look vaguely like me do? That doesn't matter. Your allegiance is to Christ. And Christ is very clear. And the New Testament is very clear. And the Catholic Church is very clear that slavery is not the Christian way. And so we rejoice on Juneteenth, not because of the color of our skin, although I'm sure it's a source of special joy for those who are descended from slaves. We rejoice, all of us, because this is something that everyone should be against, like a great evil finally being overcome. Just as, I mean, to make the connection before, if abortion is outlawed in this country, I will rejoice even though I'm not unborn. Because I care about justice, and I care about the basic values that I should care about as a Catholic.
Walt?
Yep, right on. I agree.
Excellent.
Yeah, the history has to be told truthfully, not let people like Black Lives Matter hijack these kind of holidays and, foment violence.
But it is fair to say that, I mean, when history is told accurately, quite literally, millions of Africans, sub-Saharan African people, were kidnapped from their home, dragged thousands of miles away, and they and their descendants were held in utterly unjust conditions. So I mean, certainly Arabs were involved in the slave trade. Certainly other sub-Saharan African people were involved in the slave trade and all that. But there is, I mean, and all that's important to say, but the primary thing is what happened in the United States is really something quite astonishing in the history of the world, as far as millions of people, the majority in some states, being held as slaves because of the color of their skin, and through no fault of their own, they didn't do anything. It's not even like in the ancient world where you lost a war and you got...
Or you had a debt or something like that.
Yeah, they're just taken for... And when you think about the Middle Passage, the crossing of the Atlantic, all those African bodies at the bottom of the ocean now because of what happened over hundreds of years. So do you see what I'm saying, Walt? I mean... It's true that all these other things happened,
yeah,
and they're important to say.
I do.
But it's also true to say this is a unique thing that happened in history, and it's deeply and profoundly racist.
I don't know if it's unique. I mean, people have been taking slaves forever, unfortunately, and in fact, people are still doing that in the Sudan.
Sure, yeah, that's
and
right.
And other places.
Yeah, that's
so
true.
So, unfortunately, when you look at another human being as less than human, you can do anything you want with them. That's obviously with the abortion. I mean, people in their minds can do anything they want with them. Because it's obvious with abortion, it's obvious with euthanasia. So we all have to look at each other as human beings made in the image of likeness of God, and a lot of this stuff would go away.
Well, that's certainly the case. Yes, that is without question the case. Father Hugh taught me something that I had never thought of as a Catholic, that racism is a sin twice over for the Christian.
How so?
Because first it's a sin against creation, that God created us as one, and then it's a sin against redemption. God gave his life for all of us, each and every one of us. So every time that I am a racist, for example, against a black person, then I've sinned against God the Creator, and I've sinned against Christ's sacrifice to save all people.
Yeah, I think that is very well put. And I mean, you get into the weeds in terms of the kind of the horrors and injustices that happened. And you have cases, and Pope's decrying cases, in which baptism was denied slaves because they knew they could not treat them as property if they were baptized.
Oh, yeah.
And so it was literally demonic. Like, slavery was literally a demonic institution, and it should not be a political or partisan or racial issue to be anti-demonic.
Thank you very, very much for the call. I got to take the break. This is exactly what happened to me at this exact time last hour, and then I forgot to take the break. So we'll take a quick break, be right back with more Open Forum. Joe Heschmeyer, Catholic Answers Live.
It's all about the truth. Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Underwriting by Great Catholic Music.
Great Catholic Music, your one-of-a-kind streaming platform for traditional Catholic hymns and contemporary favorites 24 hours a day. Music that soothes the soul, that's safe for the whole family to listen to. What a relief. Great Catholic Music. Download the free mobile app or listen on any Alexa-enabled device or write from your PC or tablet at greatcatholicmusic.com. Great Catholic Music, melodies for the soul.
EWTN uses the power of radio to reach people whenever and wherever they're searching for answers to questions about their Catholic faith. EWTN Radio is heard on over 500 domestic and international AM and FM radio affiliates. For a complete list of programs and how to hear EWTN Radio, visit EWTN.com and click radio. EWTN, the global Catholic network.
Do you want to end abortion, halt the attack on traditional marriage, and ensure religious freedom for ourselves and for our grandchildren? To do this, we must convert the culture. St. Paul Street Evangelization is a grassroots initiative that recognizes this need and takes it to the streets. If you're interested in peacefully sharing the gospel in your area, visit streetevangelization.com to learn more.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Joe Heschmeyer, our guest. And just as I thought, the 2 hours went really quickly because Joe is here, and that makes it an awful lot of fun. But you know what? We're going to do open forum tomorrow because the regular open forum day is Tuesday. So if we don't get to your call today, or if you're like...
you say like, regular like my two-year-old daughter. Regular.
Did she say regular?
Yeah.
Is that how I said it?
Yeah, a little bit.
Your two-year-old daughter is a genius.
Yeah.
She also says, love that
she
child.
Says regally water because she distinguishes it from sparkly water.
Oh, do you want me to tell this story?
Go ahead, my bougie daughter.
Joe is raising an elitist child who won't go to bed unless she gets Perrier.
Not Perrier. It's LaCroix. Thank you.
Oh, she has to have bubbles in her water before she goes to bed.
Yeah, she gets really annoyed if you bring her just flat water.
What are you doing, Joe? What are you doing?
I know.
Basic parenthood. Basic parenthood is you low quality stuff. You teach the child.
Yeah, I should have started her with worse food, and so she would have... start low, and then everything else feels good by comparison.
Well, I actually do think a lot of people have trouble being happy nowadays because they're basically spoiled as children. I mean, because every birthday is like they're the Roman emperor. And
right. Unfortunately, we mistreat her in a lot of other ways to balance it out.
I don't think that I wanted to hear that. Robert in Cincinnati, Ohio, listening on Sacred Heart Radio. Robert, glad you're here. Go ahead with your question for Joe.
Okay. On Catholic radio, I heard that it's a mortal sin not to believe in the perpetual virginity of Mary. And yet they say that that is not an essential thing for the mother of Jesus. So I am wondering why it's so important.
That's a very good question. Let me tease out a couple things there, if I may. One is... the sinful aspect comes like this. Like, the teaching of Jesus is one. It's whole. It's entire. And so you couldn't say, I'm going to agree with 90% of what Jesus says, and I'm going to reject the other 10%. It doesn't matter if, like, the 10% you reject isn't, like, the 10 most important percent, however you would define that. To just choose to accept some of what Jesus teaches and not all of it is not faithfulness. And that's where it becomes sinful. Like, you either totally trust Jesus or you don't. And so, likewise, when the church, using the gift given by Jesus through the Holy Spirit to the guidance into all truth, says it's important that all Christians believe X, whether you see why X is important or not, to say, I decide not to, that's where you get into sinful territory. Now, we want to modify that and say it's not inherently necessarily a sin. If someone doesn't understand why, if they're not willful, there's all sorts of things that can mitigate. But it is a serious kind of offense to say, yeah, I know the church is the body of Christ, but I still reject this authority that she has. Because from the very beginning, the church was adjudicating issues that were not always super clear in Scripture. I'll give you an example. Acts 15, Council of Jerusalem. There's a controversy about whether Gentiles need to be circumcised and whether they need to follow the Mosaic law. And the church in Acts 15, verse 28, says, it seems good to the Holy Spirit and to us, and then lays down some rules that are not found in the Old Testament, that are not found explicitly in the teachings of Jesus. And so the church has that authority, has had it in the Bible, has it still. And so to reject that authority really does compromise our relationship with the body of Christ in a serious way. That's the top line issue of, like, why is this a matter of sin in the first place? The second issue is, why is perpetual virginity important? And it is important for a lot of reasons related to Mary as the new Eve, which is how the early Christians understood her. We see this in Irenaeus in 180. It's important for understanding her as the Ark of the Covenant that's wholly dedicated to God. So holy, in the original sense, means dedicated to God. The Ark of the Covenant, for instance, only had sacred things in it. You couldn't just, like, store your nice china in there. And so in 2 Samuel 6, we see the Ark of the Covenant going through the hill country of Judah for 3 months. And Uzzah touches it and is struck dead because it's so holy it can't be touched. In Luke 1, we see Mary going into the hill country of Judah for 3 months. And the language is really parallel. And David says, how can the Ark of the Lord come to me? Elizabeth says, how is it that the mother of my Lord comes to me? And so there's a pretty explicit biblical parallel between Ark of the Covenant in the Old Covenant, mother of my Lord in the New Covenant. So all of those things matter. And in both cases, I don't know if I mentioned this or not, they're there for 3 months. David dances before the Lord wearing priestly clothes. John the Baptist, who is the son of a priest, dances before the Lord in the womb of his mother Elizabeth. And so there's some really obvious parallels between 2 Samuel 6, Luke 1. And so if Mary is the Ark of the Covenant, it makes sense that she doesn't have other kids. And this is clear from the other biblical evidence. At the crucifixion, Jesus gives Mary to the care of the Apostle John, who's a non-relative. This wouldn't have been done if there were living relatives around. It's pretty clear from this that she has no other children. Even when we hear of, like, other brothers of Jesus, so to speak, James and Joseph, they're elsewhere described as the son of Mary of Clopas. So they don't have the same mother. They don't have the same father. They're not brothers in the sense we would use that term. All of that's to say that is the biblical witness that Mary is a perpetual virgin and that this mattered because Mary is the Ark of the New Covenant, which was wholly dedicated to the Lord. And so Mary is wholly dedicated to the Lord. And the church has the authority to define these issues for the good of the faith. Does that make sense, Robert?
When you say dedicated to the Lord, if she were not a virgin, she would still could be dedicated. She's dedicated even though she's married to a man.
Well, St. Paul, think about his teachings in 1 Corinthians, where he talks about how the married woman is worried about the things of the world, and the unmarried are worried about the things of God. And so Mary is able to combine those into a singular mission. That her care about her family and her care about the Lord are one and undivided because her son is God.
Thanks, Robert. I'm going to keep moving because we had Ahmed on the line who we had a hard time hearing before, but I think we got him now, so I want to head back. Ahmed in South Dakota, are you there with us? No? Oh, well, I'm glad I rushed Robert off. still no Ahmed. All right, we'll try somebody else. Let's go to New York. Andrew in New York watching on YouTube. We are glad you're here. I hope you're here. Andrew, are you there with us?
I sure am.
Hey, Andrew, go ahead with your question.
I've been working my way through Hebrews here, and I'm caught up in 8. I was wondering if you could help me sort something out.
Sure.
Try. In 8:7, for if that first covenant had been faultless, there would be no occasion for a second. So I, knowing that God's out of time, I understand that he can see the future just as the past in the eternal now. But I was mulling this over with someone at work, and how they said that God designed the world with the second coming, with the new covenant in mind from the beginning. How can a just God have planned for the first covenant to fail and the second to be there?
That's a great question. So let me distinguish a couple things. First, specific to Hebrews 8, and then to what I feel like may be more of the heart of your question. When in Hebrews 8, when the first covenant is described as not being faultless, it's in comparison to the new covenant. So a verse prior to that. Christ has obtained a ministry which is as much more excellent than the old, as the covenant he mediates is better, since it is enacted on better promises. So there, I think that the comparison is actually that God promises good stuff in the first covenant and better stuff in the second covenant. That's faultless, meaning not that there's no moral fault in God, right? He promises something good, but that isn't enough. He promises something better. He promises actual eternal life with him, which is more than you get from the Mosaic covenant. But the other half of the question, I think, is like, why does God include his free response to our freely committed sin? And so St. Paul in Romans talks about this, that where sin abounds, grace abounds all the more. And so he warns in Romans 3, verse 8, well, why not do evil that good may come, as some people slanderously charge us with saying? And then he just says, their condemnation is just. Like, don't go sin just because God can make use of your sin. But he's getting to an important theological principle, which is this. God is all-powerful and all-good. He would only permit evil if he could draw good from it. That doesn't mean he wills the evil. It means that he wills the good that he can draw even from our rebellion, even from our sin. Likewise, you may permit your child to make a mistake, not because you want to see your child suffer or get hurt, but because you know that in letting them do that, you have an opportunity to teach them something that's maybe more important, and so forth. Now, you could just do everything for them so that no mistakes would happen, but they would never really grow. And so likewise, God permits us to struggle and even to sin, even to fail, even to fall short for our good, for our growth. And that's the basic principle, that he would only permit evil if he could draw good from it. We still are free. We are still choosing to do those evils. He isn't forcing us to do them, but he's allowing it to happen for our good, for our benefit, so that where sin abounds, grace may abound all the more. Does that help? Does that make sense?
I mean, yeah, it definitely helps a bit. I was kind of stuck on the, did God plan the Old Testament as a learning lesson?
Oh, yeah, yeah. St. Paul uses the term pedagogos.
To be perfect, and we are the fault.
No, so there's a bigger question with Eden in terms of what would happen with Adam and Eve. That's a question for another day. But certainly the Mosaic covenant was never intended as the end-all, be-all. From even going back before that with Abraham, there's the idea that through Abraham, all nations will be blessed. That God is going to do something provisional in Israel as part of a broader universal mission, that Israel is really kind of the frontline troops for what God's going to do for the world. And St. Paul gives the example of a pedagogos, which is like a teaching slave, that helps raise you, and then you outgrow. Like, it was our teacher for a while. It was our mentor. But that was always the point of the law. It was never meant to be the last word. We were promised even in Genesis 3:15 that someone will come and crush the head of Satan. So the Mosaic law was simply to prepare us for Christ.
And we will have to leave it. You could probably hear the music playing, but we're very grateful for the call, Andrew. Ahmed, we're doing open forum tomorrow, so I suggest you call and be first. Tim Staples will be here with us first hour, second hour, Carla Roussard. Both hours will be open forum. Joe Heschmeyer, thank you very much for, as always, two very fine hours.
Oh, my pleasure.
Happy Juneteenth.
Likewise.
And we'll see you tomorrow, God willing, right here, Catholic Answers Live.